اي نعم نبث الان. بامكانك تبدا ان شاء الله. بسم الله. نعم احمد.
السلام عليكم.
وعليكم السلام ورحمه الله وبركاته. نعم تفضل.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، وبعد. لا شك أن الفقه من أعظم العلوم وأنفعها للعبد، وما ذلك إلا لأن عبادته لا تستقيم ولا تصح إلا به. There's no doubt that fiqh is from the greatest of the sciences and from the most beneficial for the servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is only because the worship of the individual, the worship of the slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will not be upright, it will not be correct, it will not be sahih except by it. وَمَنْ يَجْهَلُ مَا تَجِبُ عَلَيْهِ مَعْرِفَتُهُ مِنْ لَنْ يَسْتَطِيعَ أَنْ يَتَقَرَّبِ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِ تَقَرَّبٌ صَحِيحًا. And the person who is ignorant of fiqh, doesn't have the understanding of fiqh in regarding of his ibadah and his worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then he will never be able to get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a correct manner. وَسَيُخْطِئُ كَثِيرًا فِي مُعَامَلَاتِهِ مَعَ النَّاسِ. And he is most definitely going to make many mistakes in his dealings with the people. فالحمد لله الذي أنزل الكتاب والميزان ليقوم الناس بالقسط والذي بين لنا ما علينا من الحلال والحرام. So alhamdulillah to the one who has sent down the books and the scales so that mankind will be upright upon justice, and the one who has made clear to us what is upon us of the permissible acts and the impermissible acts. فقال الله تعالى لقد أرسلنا رسلنا بالبينات وأنزلنا معهم الكتاب والميزان ليقوم الناس بالقسط. الله سبحانه وتعالى, he said, and we have most definitely sent our messengers with clear proofs and evidences, and we have sent down with them the books and the scales so that mankind will stand up upon justice. وقال الله تعالى ثم جعلناك على شريعة من الأمر فاتبعها ولا تتبع أهواء الذين لا يعلمون. الله سبحانه وتعالى, he says, and then we have now set you on the clear road of religion, meaning the Sharia, the legislation of Islam. So follow it and do not follow the whims of those who do not know. وقال الله تعالى في آية أخرى, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in another verse, ونزلنا عليك الكتاب تبيانا لكل شيء وهدى ورحمة وبشرى للمسلمين. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, and we have sent down upon you the book, bringing clarity to everything, and as a guidance and as a mercy and good news to those who have submitted themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. والفقه الإسلامي يتميز عن غيره من الأحكام والقوانين البشرية بمميزات فريدة تجعله يتفوق على غيره. And Islamic jurisprudence, Islamic fiqh, is distinguished over any of the other rulings or the man-made laws by many great distinguishing factors, unique distinguishing factors that make it superior to anything other than it, make it superior over everything else. فَأَهَمُّهَا أَنَّ الْفِقْهِ الْإِسْلَامِ فِقْهٌ إِلَهِ سَمَاوِي. So the most important of those distinguishing factors, those unique distinguishing factors, is that Islamic fiqh is a fiqh يعني that is صادر من الله تعالى. Its source is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. الَذِي يَعْلَمْ مَا يُصْلِحُ عِبَادَهُ وَمَا يَصْلِحُ لَهُمْ مِنْ أَوَّلِهِمْ إِلَىٰ آخِرِهِمْ. The one who knows what will correct his slaves and make them be upright. The one that knows what is suitable for them from the beginning of them, the beginning of mankind to the end of them. لأنه خالقهم الذي يحيط بكل ما دق وجل من شؤونهم. Because he is their creator, the one who encompasses everything that they do from the minor matters to the greater matters, everything that is found in the matters and the affairs of mankind. كما قال ربنا جل وعلا ألا يعلم من خلق وهو اللطيف الخبير. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, does he not know, does Allah not know who he has created? And he is al-latif, al-latif, the subtle, the one who knows the most subtle and hidden of things, al-khabir, the most aware. فحكمه أعدل وأحكم وأكمل الحكم. So his حكم, Allah, when he makes a legal ruling, when he makes a ruling, it is the most just and the most perfect and the most complete of rulings. ومن أسماء الله الحسنى الحكيم وهو الذي يضع كل شيء في موضعه فحكمه لا يأتريه نقص من أي وجه من الوجوه. And from the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the, his most beautiful, perfect names is Al-Hakim. He is the one who puts everything in its perfect place. So his ruling will never have any deficiency in it due to his great, great, perfect wisdom and his great, great, perfect knowledge of everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَلَيْسَ اللَّهُ بِأَحْكَمِ الْحَاكِمِينَ. Is Allah not the greatest of the judges? ولذلك نجد أن الفقه الإسلامي قد غطى كل جانب من جوانب حياة البشر في كل ما يحتاجه في دينه ودنياه. And because of that, we see that the fiqh of Islam, the jurisprudence of Islam, has covered every angle from the different angles of the life of man, and in regards to everything that he needs in his religion and in his life, daily life. وأعطى كل ذي حق حقه, and has given every person deserving of a right his right. ولأجل شموله ورسوخ قواعده وأن مصدره من الله تعالى أنه صالح لكل زمان ومكان ولكل ما يستجد من الحوادث والنوازل على مر العصور. And because of the completeness of this fiqh of Islam, of this jurisprudence of Islam, and its deeply rooted principles and fundamentals, and due to the fact that its source is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is suitable for every time and every place, and for all those new matters that come about through the passing of time. Now, I just wanted to give my brothers and sisters a small introduction of the great lofty status of fiqh in Islam before we get into the introductory points. Because it is important to understand that this fiqh is sources from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inshallah, we were able to make that clear. Moving on to the المبادل العشرة, the 10 introductory points. لكل علم مبادئ ينبغي لقاصد ذلك العلم أن يعرفها لأن يتصوره قبل شروعه فيه. For every science or mabadi that is appropriate for every individual who is seeking out that science, wanting to study that science, that he knows them, so he has an understanding of what he's getting himself into, has an understanding of what this science consists of. So firstly, al-had, يعني the definition of it. And we're going to talk about firstly, give a brief understanding of its linguistic meaning, and then getting into more detail with its scientific terminology. So firstly, lughatan, يعني linguistically, it means al-fiqh, it means al-fahm. It means al-fahm, understanding. Al-fiqh, in Arabic, it has the same meaning in the linguistic, if you look at it linguistically, as the word al-fahm, for those who have some understanding of Arabic. تقول فقهت الحديث أي فهمته. You say, يعني understood the hadith, you say فقهته أو فهمته, يعني means the same meaning. Whether that the thing that you're understanding is something that was daqiq, something that was intricate, or something that was simple. يعني al-fiqh and fahm has the same, basically the same meaning in the if you look at it linguistically. Then, the word fiqh became famous as the ilm of Sharee'ah, the ilm, the science of the jurisprudence of Islam. It became used as the name of that science, al-fiqh. And the scholar of this science, he is called al-faqih, which is also is a derivative or is taken and derived from the word fiqh. And the plural of faqih is fuqaha. And they're all taken from that word, al-fiqh. Na'am, to move on to the istilahan, meaning or the scientific terminology of the word al-fiqh. Firstly, we'll give you it in Arabic and then we'll break it down in English, inshallah ta'ala, and try to give a small understanding of each word or each part of the ta'rif, each part of the definition. هو العلم بالأحكام الشرعية العملية المكتسب من أدلتها التفصيلية. What does that mean? It is the knowledge of Islamic legal rulings tied to the actions of the servant that are extracted from specific proofs and evidences that are found in the major proofs and evidences of the Sharia. This last part of the ta'rif definition, when I said that are extracted from specific proofs and evidences that are found in the major proofs and evidences of the Sharia. Inshallah, the ones who study or sat in the lecture and listened to the lecture of our brother Abdul Salam, they have some understanding now of usul fiqh. And the reason we're trying to make a distinction between specific proofs and evidences that are found in the major proofs and evidences of the Sharia is because usul fiqh deals with the proofs and evidences of the Sharia, meaning the Quran as a whole, the Sunnah as a whole, يعني the ijma' of the ulama as a whole, the consensus of the ulama as a whole, the qiyas or the aqisa, يعني analogic reasoning of the ulama. So you studied that with Abdul Salam. So when I'm saying specific proofs and evidences, meaning those specific proofs and evidences that are found in those proofs, for example, the Quran, you can make a legal ruling or legal rulings that can be taken out from one verse in the Quran or one part of a verse. يعني, so when I say specific proofs and evidences, meaning specific proofs and evidences that are found in the Quran, meaning an ayah or a group of ayat and so on, or a hadith or a group of a hadith and so on. Na'am. And we said in the ta'rif, huwa al-ilm. يعني هو العلم, meaning العلم, it is the knowledge which is the opposite of jahl, the opposite of ignorance. And when in this ta'rif, in this definition, knowledge, it means to comprehend something in the same way that it is in reality. And then we said هو العلم بالأحكام, بالأحكام meaning rulings. It is what the Sharia has called to or pointed to or pointed towards of requesting an action, or requesting a prohibition, or giving us يعني the choice, يعني التخيير, from doing something or leaving it off. بالأحكام الشرعية. الشرعية meaning المأخوذة من الشرع, يعني it was taken from the legislation, from the legislation, يعني the proofs and evidences of the legislation of Islam. العملية, يعني العلم بالأحكام الشرعية العملية, meaning المتعلقة بعمل العبد كصلاته وصيامه وحجه وعمل قلبه كنواياه, meaning المتعلقة بعمل العبد, what was connected to the works of the slave or the actions of the servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like his prayer or his fasting or his pilgrimage or even some works of his heart, like his intentions. المكتسب, meaning يعني معناه المستنبط بالنظر والاجتهاد, meaning it was extracted by the عالم or the مجتهد, the great jurist, the major jurist, يعني exerting himself to bring out a حكم شرعي, bring out a legal ruling of the legislation of Islam. من أدلتها التفصيلية, meaning ما جاء في القرآن والسنة والإجماع والقياس, everything that came in the Quran of ayat and what came in the Sunnah of a hadith and what came in the إجماعات of the ulama and the أقسه of the different madhahib, of the different schools of thoughts, يعني different analogic reasonings of the schools of thought of the Muslimin. And we're not going to get into too deep in what these things mean, because that was more of يعني the muhadara or the class of usul al-fiqh. And Abdul Salam, inshallah ta'ala, he made that clear to the brothers and sisters that listen to it. May Allah reward him and reward you all. Ameen. Moving on to al-mawdu', yani mawdu'uhu, its subject, the subject of fiqh. Yani it is the actions of the mukallafin. It is the actions of the mukallafin, those who have reached puberty and have sanity, their actions in regards to them being requested to do them. Yani those actions that those who are mukallaf, yani who have reached puberty and have their sanity, when they begin to be commanded to do actions and requested to do actions, and those actions that they are commanded to do, or the things that they are commanded to leave off, they are always going to be connected to seven ahkam, to seven rulings. The first of them, al-wajib. The first of them, الواجب. وهو ما طلب الشارع فعله طلبا جازما كإجابة الصلاة. the obligatory matter. It is what Allah has requested or commanded of an action while making it obligatory, meaning we have no choice in the matter, we must do it. Then we have al-mustahab, yani the praiseworthy, recommended action. وهو ما طلب الشارع فعله طلبا غير جازما غير جازما كنوافل الصلاة. It is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has requested or commanded of an action while not making it obligatory, but making it something that is praiseworthy and recommended that we do it and not leave it off. But if you did leave it off, there is no sin in that. والمباح هو ما لم يطلبه الشارع فعله ولا تركه كالاغتسال التبرد. المباح, يعني the permissible action. It is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not order for its action to come about, did not make it prohibited, like يعني taking a shower to cool off or something like that, or eating or sleeping and things like this, of the permissible actions. Then we have المحرم or المحظور. وهو ما طلب الشارع تركه طلبا جازما كعقوق الوالدين والغيبة. Yani the prohibited action. It is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has requested or commanded of the abstaining of a thing while making the abstaining of that thing obligatory, meaning we have no choice in that. We must abstain from it. We must stay away from it. Then we have al-makruh. وهو ما طلب الشارع تركه طلبا غير جازم كالأخذ والإعطاء بالشمال. Al-makruh, yani the translates to be, yani the disliked matter. And it is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered or requested with the prohibition of it or leaving it off. But if a person was to fall into it or to do it, there will be no sin upon him, but it is better for the individual to stay away from it. Na'am. And then we have as-sihha, yani the valid, yani validity or the soundness of an action or of a worship or a dealing. وَهِيَ مَا وَافِقَ الشَّرْعَ وَذَلِكَ يَكُونِ إِذَا توفرت الشروط وانتفت الموانع. الصحة, يعني the sound action or the sound ruling. It is what was in agreement with the Sharia. And that comes about if all of the shurut or conditions of that worship, of that dealing were met. And if all of the mawani, those things that prevent that action or that ibadah or that dealing from being able to be done, are not present. For example, we give a small example. من الموانع, from the things that prevent ibadah from being sound or being correct or being able to come about, is like the menstrual cycle of our women. It is considered a mani from the salah, something that prevents the salah from being correct. So when a woman is on her menstrual cycle, she is not allowed to pray because that there's a mani there. There's something that's preventing the soundness of salah, and that is the menstrual cycle, for example. And then we have al-fasad, yani the invalid, the legal rule, the ruling that points to in something being invalid. وهو ما لم يوافق الشرع إما لعدم توفر شرط من الشروط أو لوجود مانع كحيد المرأة للصلاة. We use the same example. يعني al-fasad, invalid, يعني the legal ruling or the ruling that points to something being invalid, it is what was not in agreement with the Sharia, not in agreement with the Shar, not in agreement with the legislation. Either because of a condition not being met from the conditions that need to be met, or because there was something preventing it, a mani, like the same example we just gave, the menstrual cycle of the woman, which is a mani from the salah. Na'am. Now we move on to al-thamara. Al-thamara, the fruits and the benefits that come about from studying the science. يعني صحة العبادة. صحة العبادة, that is the main reason of this science. صحة العبادة, for the correctness and the soundness of worship, so that we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way He wants to be worshipped. صحة العبادة. فبالفقه صلاتك تكون صحيحة. Because with fiqh, with understanding fiqh, having understanding of fiqh, your salah will be correct. وحجك يكون صحيحاً, and your pilgrimage, the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the acts of the pilgrimage will be correct if you have understanding of fiqh. وصحة المعاملات, and the soundness of the different dealings. يعني فبالفقه يصح بيعك واشتراؤك والعقود. Because with fiqh, your معاملات, your dealings will be correct. Like you're buying and selling and the different contracts that are found in the books of fiqh and things like this will be correct. وكذلك امتثال أمر الله. And as well, from the fruits and benefits of fiqh is امتثال أمر الله, being able to follow the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being able to act upon the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فنتعلم الحلال فنفعله ونتعلم الحرام فنجتنبه. So we learn the halal, the permissible thing, so that we can do it. And we learn the haram actions so that we may stay away from them and abstain from them. ونتعلم الفضائل المستحبات فنسعى إليها. And we learn the فضائل المستحبات, we learn the فضائل, the virtuous actions and the recommended and praiseworthy actions so that we can do them. This is all found in the books of fiqh. So a person does not have knowledge of fiqh, how is he going to know what's mustahab from what's wajib and things like this? How can he know what is praiseworthy? And fahimt? We understand that, right? These are the fruits of fiqh. These are the fruits and benefits that come about from studying fiqh. You'll be able to get closer to your Lord. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is the maqsood. That is the intention of the real intention of fiqh. Sihhat al-ibadah, having correct ibadah, being able to get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because you are bayyinah, you have clarity in your religion. Then, thirdly, وَأَن نَعْرَفِ السُنَّةِ من البدعة والصواب من الخطأ حتى لا نقع فيه. Thirdly, to know the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah from bid'ah, from innovation in the religion. You can tell the difference. You know what is correct and what is wrong. You know what's from the sunnah of the Messenger of Allah and what has been innovated. So we learn the sunnah, we're able to do it. We learn innovation, we learn what's innovation, what was innovated, and we stay away from it. We learn what is correct in regards to bring about different acts of worship, so that we can follow and do it and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala correctly. And we learn what is the akhtar and the different mistakes and things that that people do or Muslims do when they bring about these acts of worship in a wrong manner, so that we can stay away from them and not fall into them. Naam. Wa nisbatuhu, moving on to nisbah. Yani what's it attributed to? Yani huwa min al-ulum al-shar'iyya. It is from the sciences of the Sharia, from the sciences of the Sharia, كعلم العقيدة وعلم تفسير, like the science of عقيدة and the science of تفسير, the science of the creed and the belief system of the believers and the science of the explanation of the Quran. And it's من علوم الغاية, يعني from those sciences that are the, يعني those sciences, the intended sciences, that those intended sciences that are needed to understand the deen, understand the deen. Not from the ulum al-ala, not from those assisting sciences that were made to help us understand those sciences, like the science of aqidah, or the science of fiqh, or the science of tafsir, or the science of hadith. It's from the major sciences of Islam, ulum al-ghaya. Naam. Moving on to its fadl, yani its virtue. Fadluhu, awwalan, yiqul ulama anna ilm al-fiqh afdalu ilmin بعد علم التوحيد والعقيدة. The ulama say that the science of fiqh is the greatest science after the science of التوحيد and عقيدة, after the science of learning about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yani the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the belief system, yani learning the creed and the belief system. That's the first and most, the greatest of the sciences. And the ulama say that the greatest science after is علم الفقه. وورد في فضل الفقه آيات وأحاديث كثيرة. And many ayat and many hadith came making clear the virtue of fiqh in the religion. So we mentioned a few of them, inshallah تعالى. فمنها قول الله تعالى فلولا نفر من كل فقه منهم طائفة ليتفقهوا في الدين ولينذروا قومهم إذا رجعوا إليهم لعلهم يحذرون. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in Surah At-Tawbah, and it is not for the believers to go forth all out in battle, all at once together. But rather there should be separate, but there should be separate from them, but there should separate from every division of them, a group remaining back to obtain understanding in the religion. To obtain understanding in the religion so that they may warn their people when they return to them so that they may be aware. This is a clear proof showing a fiqh fi deen. التفقه في الدين, يعني showing the importance and the high lofty status of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of having comprehension and understanding in the religion. The fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, yani it's not for all the believers to all go out once in the battles all at once, but rather there should be some that stay back and seek knowledge of this religion, yani seek comprehension of this religion, so that those who went out to fight, when they come back, they may warn them and teach them of what they learned of goodness and of fiqh and understanding of the religion. Allahu Akbar. وقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من يريد الله به خيرا يفقهه في الدين. Famous hadith of the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, whoever Allah wants good for, then he grants him comprehension of the religion. Yani he makes him understand the religion, grants him comprehension, understanding of the religion. وقال تعالى الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا. قال الفضيل ابن عياض أحسن العمل أخلصه وأصوبه ولا يعلم الصواب إلا من كان عالما بشرع الله عز وجل فقيها بأحكام. الله سبحانه وتعالى, he says in سورة الملك, the one who has created death and life so that he may test you all to see who will be best in deeds, يعني best in actions. الفضيل ابن عياض, he said, the best of deeds are those that are most sincere and most correct. He said, the best of deeds are those that are most sincere and most correct. And no one will know what is correct from the deeds except the one who was a scholar of the legislation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Faqihan, yani having understanding of his ahkam, having understanding, strong understanding of the rulings of fiqh. Now, moving on to al-wadi', yani translates to be founder of the science. هم المجتهدون من فقهاء الصحابة ومن جاء بعدهم من فقهاء ومجتهدي هذه الأمة. يعني they are the wadi', or the founder of this science. They are the great major jurisprudic scholars of the Sahaba. And those who came after them of the great major scholars and major jurists from the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the most famous of them are four. The most famous of them are four. Firstly, Al-Imam Abu Hanifa al-Nu'man ibn Thabit, rahimahullah, al-mutawaffa sana 150. The one who has passed away in the year 150. And he is the Imam of the Hanafi Madhab. He is the Imam of the Hanafi Madhab, and he is of the first of the four great Imams that their Madhab has spread across the world. Then comes Al-Imam Malik ibn Anas Al-Asbahi, Imam Dar al-Hijrah, Al-Mutawaffa Sana 179. We have Imam Malik ibn Anas Al-Asbahi, the Imam of the place of migration, meaning Al-Madinah, who has passed away in the year 179, and he is the Imam of the Maliki Madhab. He is the Imam of the Maliki Madhab. Then we have, after him, Al-Imam Muhammad ibn Idris al-Shafi'i, al-Mutawaffa sana 204, the one who has passed away in the year 204. And he is the Imam of the Shafi'i Madhab. And then we have after him, last but not least, Al-Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal al-Shaybani, Imam Ahl al-Sunnah, al-Mutawaffa sana 241. We have Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal al-Shaybani, the Imam of the people of Sunnah, was passed away in the year 241, and he is the Imam of the Hanbali Madhab. Naam. Moving on to yani asma'uhu aw ismuhu, yani the name of it or its names. Yusamma ilm al-fiqh is called the science of fiqh, the science of jurisprudence. وَيُسَمَّى عِلْمِ الْحَلَالِ وَالْحَرَامِ, and is called the science of يعني the permissible things and the impermissible things. وَيُسَمَّى الْفِقْهِ الْأَصْغَرِ وَيُقَابِلُهُ الْفِقْهِ الْأَكْبَرِ الَّذِي هُوَ عِلْمُ الْعَقِيدَ, and is called يعني the minor fiqh in regards to the major fiqh, which is the science of aqidah. يعني you call the science of Aqidah is called Al-Fiqh Al-Akbar, and the great fiqh. and al-fiqh jurisprudence, yani is called al-fiqh al-asghar when it's compared to ilm al-aqidah, the science of aqidah. Now we have istimdaduhu, yani what is derived from istimdaduhu, what is derived from, what is the science of fiqh derived from? Yustamaddu min al-Qur'ani wa sunnah wa al-ijma' wa al-qiyas. It is derived from the Quran and from the Sunnah and from ijma' al-ulama. And that is yani ijma', just quick brief understanding, what is the ijma' of ulama? Yani is the, means it roughly translates to consensus of the ulama, meaning the agreement or the coming to a conclusion of ulama in a time period from the ulama of the Ummah of Muhammad regarding an affair of the affairs of religion. And they have ittifaq, they are in agreement regarding it. And that is from the adilla, the proofs and evidence that are agreed upon amongst the ulama, ijma' al-ulama. The Prophet ﷺ said, my ummah will not come together upon misguidance. لا تجتمع أمتي على الضلال. My ummah will not come together upon dalal. That is the proofs and evidence of ijma'. Pretty sure our brother Abdul Salam made that clear to you. Oh. Well, qiyas and qiyas, it is taken from al qiyas as well. And qiyas, yani for example, it is how we see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made khamr in the Quran, yani alcohol in the Quran haram. And the reasoning the ulama say of that is because of the fact that it removes the rationality of an individual. Makes him act like a crazy individual, removes his rationality. And that is the illa, that is the reasoning of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, making it haram. So anything that resembles that and shares in it, in the same illa, the same reasoning, for example, different drugs that remove your rationality and make you act like a crazy individual and things like this, we find that it has taken the same legal ruling as khamr. And that is the example of qiyas. نعم حكمه يعني حكم تعلمه and the ruling of it or the ruling of learning it إما فرض عيني كصفة الصلاة وصفة الوضوء وكيفية الحج لمن يريد أن يحج. It's either, we find that the ruling of it, the ruling of learning is either فرض عيني, meaning that it's obligatory mandatory upon every individual of the Ummah of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam to learn it. Learn it, you know, in regards to, for example, how to pray. Every individual from the Ummah of Muhammad has to learn how to pray. This is from fiqh. Or al-wudu, how to make wudu, how to make ablution. Every individual from the Ummah of Muhammad has to learn how to make ablution, how to make wudu. And this is from fiqh. Or for example, how to make hajj for an individual who wants to embark on the pilgrimage and make hajj. He has to learn how to make hajj. It becomes obligatory upon him. يعني فرضٌ عيني upon him. It becomes obligatory upon him once he starts to want to make hajj. Or a person who wants to yuzakki, he wants to give his zakah. Now it's upon him to learn how to give his zakah. How much is upon him to give the zakah? This is found in the books of fiqh. And these are a few examples. وما زاد على ذلك من تفاصيل هذا العلم فهو فرض كفائي يقوم به فقهاء هذه الأمة. And what is in increase upon that, or what is extra after that, يعني in more detail, or يعني what is extra than the things that if you do not know them, your salah, when your ibadah will not be correct, يعني those extra تفاصيل, those extra details, then that is فرض كفائي. Meaning that a few of the ummah, a few people of the ummah of Muhammad, if they do it, then the sin leaves from the whole ummah. And if it's a correct amount or a sufficient amount from the ummah of Muhammad that learn these masail and get deep into the intricate details of fiqh, then that will be sufficient. And it is not upon everyone, it is not upon the whole ummah of Muhammad to have to learn all the different tafasir and intricate details of fiqh. Rather, this is for the fuqaha of this ummah and the talabat al-ilm of this ummah, for the students of knowledge of this ummah and from those great scholars of fiqh of this ummah. نعم. ومسائله يعني the matters or issues or affairs that are studied in this in this science يعني هي المسائل التي موجودة في كتب الفقه. They are the مسائل, they are the affairs or issues or matters that are found in the books of fiqh. مثلا العبادات والمسائل التي تتعلق بها. For example, the acts of worship like الصلاة, الحج, الصوم, fasting, and all of the مسائل, all of the affairs and matters that are connected to these different acts of worship. And the كيفية of these acts of worship, how do you do these acts of worship and things like this. والمعاملات والمسائل التي تتعلق بها. And the different dealings that the different everyday dealings that we find connected to mankind. And those affairs that are connected to them. All of those affairs are connected to them. We find those also in the books of fiqh. They are from the affairs and matters that fiqh covers. والنكاح والنكاح and marriage and marrying, things like this. And all of the affairs and matters that are connected to that. And a person should not think that just marriage. Allah, it is many ahkam is connected to it. Before the marriage, the contract of the marriage, the conditions that need to be met, شرط الولي, يعني الطلاق, divorcing, how does divorce go about, الخلع, يعني, and things like this, there's many ahkam that are connected to marriage. يعني the children, when children come, يعني if he gave her the mahar, if he gave her the dowry, he didn't give her the dowry, what are these masalas connected to a marriage? It's very, very much a lot. يعني. So a person should not think when I say nikah, marriage, oh, that's simple. There's many, many masalas connected to it. And you will know when you study and get into the books of fiqh, inshallah ta'ala. والجنايات. And that is, Islamic criminal jurisprudence. Islamic criminal jurisprudence. And all this masail, all of the affairs and the matters that are connected to it. These are the masail of fiqh. These are the matters and issues and affairs that are studied and found in the science of fiqh. Moving on to, how does a beginner student study this science? How does a beginner student study this science? يقول كثير من العلماء أن أنسب طريقة لدراسة الفقه للمبتدئ هي طريقة دراسة المتون الفقهية. Many علماء, they said that the most appropriate way for studying fiqh for the beginner is by studying the books of fiqh, studying the texts of fiqh. يعني المتون الفقهية, studying those texts and those books that the fuqaha have authored. يعني servicing a madhab, making clear the fiqh or the understanding of a madhab. فعليه أولا يختار مذهبا من المذاهب الأربعة المشهورة ويختار منها المتداول في بلده. So firstly, it's upon him or her to choose a school of thought from the four مشهورة, the four famous schools of thought, and he chooses the way he chooses from them as he looks into the one that is most widespread in his country. إما الفقه يعني المذهب الحنفي أو المذهب المالكي أو المذهب الشافعي أو المذهب الحنبلي. The one that is متداول or widespread in his country, that would be best for him or best for her to choose that one. Then, secondly, ثم يبحث عن شيخ عالم متقن لذلك المذهب. Then he goes out or she goes out and looks for a sheikh that is a scholar who has perfected that madhab. الذي اشتهر للعلم والورع وحسن التعليم. The one who has become famous and known for having a strong knowledge and grasp of that madhab, and known to be pious and known to be a good teacher and be able to teach people in a good manner. وغالبا هذا يعرف من قوة طلابه الذين تفقهوا على يده سابقا. And most of the time you find this out by looking to the students who have studied fiqh upon his hand before or previously. Most of the time you find that the quality of the sheikh based off his students. This is not something that is always, but this is of the ways, من الوسائل, it's of the ways that you find out the level of a sheikh. You just look at his students. وطبعا هذا إذا أمكن. And of course what I mentioned of you looking for a sheikh that's a mutqin, perfecting this madhab, a great scholar of the madhab, and he's famous for knowledge and he's extremely pious and things like that. This is the best thing and this is the best that we are trying to look for. That's the first option. But of course you do what's possible. If you don't find someone by meeting all these criteria or qualities, then you find the next one up, inshallah ta'ala. I'm saying this as an example. If you find that, if there's someone like that in your country or in the country that you're studying, then that's the individual you should go to. And that would be best for you. ثالثاً ثم يبدأ بأصغر متن من متون ذلك المذهب. Then he begins with the most beginner متن, the most beginner text from the text of that madhab. فيبدأ بالمتون الصغيرة ثم المتوسطة ثم المطولة. So he begins with the beginner text first. It begins with the beginning. This is a very extremely important point that we must point out. Please pay attention, my brothers and sisters. He begins with the most beginner texts, or she begins with the most beginner texts that are found in that madhab. Then, if you have perfected or done those mutun well, or done those and studied those texts well, then you go to the more intermediate texts. Then, if you've done those well, perfected them, then you go to al-mutawwala, the more advanced texts that are usually for the advanced students of knowledge and the ulama. وَلَا يَنْتَقِلُ إِلَى الْكِتَابِ الَّذِي بَعْدَهُ حَتَّى يُتْقِنَ الَّذِي قَبْلَهُ. And he does not move on to the book that is after the book he is studying until he has perfected or done well the book that he's studying at the present time. Doesn't jump from book to book. يعني want to look into the advanced books and look into the more intermediate books and he's still on a beginner level. Stay in your lane. Wallahi, هذا خير بركه, that you're studying these beginner books, building your asas, building your foundation. Don't be book jumping, class jumping, and things like that. Sit and study fiqh the way the ulama have studied fiqh. Study Islam the way the ulama have studied Islam. بالتدرج, يعني with progression, level to level. This is how you become a strong student. This is how you become an alim. Do not become deluded by some of the people who are in a beginner level and they're studying and reading big books and things like that. Do not allow them to divert you from what you're doing and doing ta'asir al-ilm. Yani you're getting a foundation in the knowledge that you're studying. And another reason of you shouldn't be going from book to book or jumping to the next book before you perfected that book that you're studying at that time, لأن الفروع الفقهية كثيرة, because the branches of fiqh are abundant. The branches of fiqh are abundant, very much. ومتنوعة, and many different types. وهي تتفلت بدون إتقانها, and they will leave you. They will leave you if you don't perfect them at the time that you're studying them. هذا مشاهد. This is something that is known by students of knowledge and known by the ulama. فإذا لم تتقن المتون الأساسية لمذهبك, فإذا لم تتقن المتون الأساسية لمذهبك لن تستطيع أن تستوعب ما يأتي بعده لأنه غالبا مبني عليه. And if you did not perfect those fundamental texts of your madhab, then you will never be able to truly comprehend or understand or grasp those books that come after it, because most of the time they are built upon those fundamental books. Most of the time, they're built on those fundamental books. Those beginner books are preliminary for those more advanced books. So if you do not do those beginner books well, it will be extremely difficult to get into the more advanced books. And you will have a hard time. And we see many people, they leave off talab al-ilm altogether because they found su'uba, they found difficulty and hardship. And we'll talk about that in the advices at the end of the lesson, inshallah ta'ala. Fourthly, al-i'rad an khilaf al-ulama fi bidayati tariqik. Fourthly, turning away and not paying attention to the differences of opinions of the ulama in the beginning of your study of fiqh. والتركيز على مذهب واحد وعلى قول واحد, and focusing upon one madhab, the madhab that you're studying, and focusing upon one opinion in that madhab, except in the times of it's a must. For example, if your teacher felt the need to mention more than one opinion, or is in time you're trying to get fatwa or things like this, and you need to do an act of worship immediately, you don't know what to do, and the alim, he gave you a different opinion from the opinion that you found in your madhab or whatever the case may be. But besides that, do not busy yourself with the different opinions or the different aqwal of the ulama or the different opinions or understandings of the different schools of thoughts in the beginning of your study of fiqh. Because if you busy yourself with the different understandings of the schools of thoughts in the beginning of you studying the science, it will be extremely difficult for you to understand fiqh. It will become extremely difficult for you to understand fiqh and to understand the fundamentals of fiqh and the principles of fiqh that differ from madhab to madhab, that may differ from madhab to madhab, from school of thought to the next school of thought. And that is what is studied in usul al-fiqh. And then, khamisan, fifthly, what is upon us is to have al-jam' bain al-hifdi wal-fahm. Yani to gather between, in our study, memorization and striving to understand. فلا يهمل أيا منهما. So he does not, or she does not, neglect one of them and focus on the other. Yani he does not focus on understanding and then does not memorize. Or does not just memorize and not give a care about understanding. Because the masail of fiqh, the affairs or the matters of fiqh are abundant, as we have mentioned. And if you have not memorized a metin or a beginner text in the madhab, that have the fundamental, or as they say, yani urus al-aqlam, yani the most important masail of in fiqh found in them, then it'll be very, very easy for you to forget much of what you have studied. And so we give you a practical example of how do you do that. For example, it's upon you before you go to the dars of your sheikh. For example, if you begin, you found your sheikh, you have your madhab, and you have your lessons, you have a schedule. How do you go about that now? How do you gather between memorizing and having understanding at the same time? For example, عليك أن تبدأ بالحفظ أولا. Firstly, you memorize the text. Memorize the matin. Memorize what is going to be taught. And then, after you have memorized it and memorized it well, then you go to the dars of your sheikh. Then you go to the class of your sheikh. After you have finished memorizing. وأثناء الدرس, and at the time of the dars, at the time of when your sheikh is giving the sharh, the explanation of the dars, of the lesson, then what is upon you is to pay attention, be attentive throughout the class. وتدون ملاحظاته, and you write down and record those things that your sheikh has pointed to and explained in the class. And you write down those fawa'id and those benefits that he's mentioned in the class. And that way you have gathered between memorizing awwal and first. Then when you went to your class of the sheikh, you gained the understanding of what you memorized and you took down notes to gain further understanding. And the individual who was not able to memorize for whatever reason, we're not saying that he will never or she will never be able to learn fiqh. We're not saying that. We're not saying that the individual will not be able to learn fiqh. That is not what we're saying. But what we're saying is that gathering between memorization and understanding is always going to be better for you and is what the ulama always advise with. From the expertise, they always advise with it. They know that this science is not difficult, but it's many. The furu' or the branches of fiqh are abundant. The masail are abundant and numerous. So you need to have something that you've memorized in your heart that you always can go back to. So it will always be better for you if you memorize one of the beginner texts. Inshallah ta'ala. Nextly, يعني, we're going to get into the books that a beginner student can progress with in his beginning of studying the science of fiqh. أولا كتب الفقه كثيرة جدا والمقصود من تأليفها يختلف من كتاب إلى كتاب ومن مذهب إلى مذهب. Firstly, the books of fiqh are many, many. And the purpose of them being authored differ from book to book. And they differ from madhab to madhab. For example, some books are made for beginners. Some books were made for more intermediate level students. Some books were made for advanced level students and ulama. Some books, they only have mentioning of the ahkam and the rulings. Some they gathered between mentioning the adillah, all of the adillah, and mentioning the ahkam together. Some they only mention a few adillah, the most important adillah, and they mention more of the ahkam and legal and the rulings. Some they are comparative fiqh, and they mention the different understandings from the different madhahib, the different schools of thought. But على سبيل المثال, for example, a few books, we mention a few books from the Hanbali madhab that a beginner student should get to know and should be looking to study in his beginning stages of studying ilm al-fiqh, the science of fiqh, through the madhab of Imam Ahmad. فأولا, first book we mentioned is أخص المقتصرات لمحمد بدر الدين ابن بلبان الدمشقي. أخص المقتصرات, the book that was authored by Muhammad بدر الدين ابن بلبان الدمشقي, passed away in the year 1083 هجري. Next, we have عمدة الطالب للشيخ منصور ابن يونس البهوتي علامة المذهب, who passed away in the year 1051 هجري. And then we have دليل الطالب للشيخ مرعي الكرمي, who passed away in the year 1033. Then we have كافي المبتدي للشيخ محمد ابن بدر الدين البلبان الدمشقي, who is also the author of أخص المختصرات, the first book that we mentioned. Then we have fifthly زاد المستقنع للشيخ شرف الدين, that was authored by the Sheikh شرف الدين أبو النجاة موسى ابن أحمد الحجاوي, that passed away in the year 960. And we have, and before I move on to the next book, that's one of the more famous books of the Mutaakhiri, of the Hanabila, of the later scholars of the Hanabila, that is focused on hatta this day, even up to this day, that are studied, and you find it of the most famous books and most beneficial books of the Hanbali Madhab in this day and age, Zad al-Mustaqni'. And then we have finally الشرح, the explanation of it, which is الروض المربع. شرح زاد المستقنع. الروض المربع is the explanation of the book we just mentioned, زاد المستقنع. That was authored by Sheikh Mansur ibn Yunus al-Bahuti. Passed away in the year 1051. ولا يجب عليه يعني أن يحفظ كل هذه الكتب بل يحاول أن يحفظ أحدها إما أخص المختصرات أو عمدة الطالب أو زاد المستقنع والأفضل أن يحفظ منها أو أن يحفظ منها هو زاد المستقنع. And it is not incumbent or obligatory upon the beginner student to memorize all these books. We're not saying that. We don't want anyone to take that, to think that that's what we're trying to say. أبداً, at all. But rather we're saying, let him choose one of these books. Let him choose one of these beginner books and strive to memorize it. Any of the first ones that we mentioned. Specifically, rather it be أخص المختصرات or it can be عمدة الطالب or زاد المستقنع. And the best and the most beneficial of these books to memorize, of these small texts, of these texts to memorize is زاد المستقنع. And most of the ulama, we find them advising with the memorization of زاد المستقنع because it has more مسائل and is be more beneficial for the beginner student of the Hanbali madhab to memorize it. وكذلك also لا يجب عليه أن يدرس كل هذه الكتب بل إذا اختصر على مثلا عمدة الطالب ثم زاد المستقنع ثم شرحه الروض المربع يكفيه ذلك. And also we're not saying that it's incumbent or obligatory upon him to study all these books and perfect every single one of these books. But rather saying فمثلا if he studied عمدة الطالب first, did it well, studied it well, then he moved on to, for example, زاد المستقنع, studied it well, maybe memorized it, or memorized Umd al-Talib, one of them. Then he studies the sharh of it, the sharh of Zad al-Mustaqni', which is Ar-Rud al-Murbi', then that will be sufficient for him. And an individual who studies these books and does them well, most definitely he will obtain a great knowledge, a great abundant amount of knowledge, inshallah ta'ala. And you have a great foundation in fiqh. وَلَا سِيَمَا الْفِقْهِ الْحَمْدُلِي. Especially the fiqh of the madhab of Imam Ahmad. Lastly, we're moving on to advices and some personal experiences. أولا أنصح لمن يريد أن يقبل على طلب العلم أو طلب علم الفقه أن يبدأ بحفظ كتاب الله وأن يعتني به وأن يكون له ورد يوميا من القرآن. Firstly, my first advice, the best advice that I can give to any individual wanting to embark upon seeking any knowledge of the knowledges or the sciences of Islam, is to begin with the memorization of the Book of Allah. Begin with the memorization of the Book of Allah, and to give it care and be diligent regarding the Book of Allah, and stick to the Book of Allah, and memorize the Book of Allah, and learn the Book of Allah before he becomes busy with the sciences or the different sciences that he wants to study. First, make that his first goal, to complete the memorization of the Book of Allah, to have a bit or a part or a wird, yani a portion of the Quran that he reviews or she reviews or he memorizes or studies every single day. And there's a few reasons why. Firstly, there's many reasons why, but we only gonna mention a few, inshallah ta'ala. لأن بحفظ كلام الله والعناية به تنزل البركة وصاحب القرآن دائما يكون موفقا. Because with the memorization of the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and giving it care, the barakah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come down. The barakah, the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come down upon the sahib al-Quran, upon the person who is sincere and striving to memorize the Book of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send down his barakah, his blessing upon the individual. And da'im, in all the time, we find that the companion of the Quran, the sincere companion of the Quran, he's always successful. Allah always gives that individual success. And wallahi, we need barakah and we need success when we're studying any science from the sciences of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the sciences of the Islamic knowledges. Because al-ilm nur, knowledge is nur, knowledge is life from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not just gathering ma'lumat, wallahi that. It's not just gathering ma'lumat, not just gathering يعني, facts and things like this, and wallahi la. Ilm is nur from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yaqdifuhu fi qalbi al-abd. Knowledge is light from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he cast into the heart of the sincere one who is striving to remove jahil from himself, remove ignorance from himself, and wants to benefit the ummah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him from his nur, from the understanding of the Quran, the understanding of the sunnah, the understanding of the Jewish punas of Islam. That is nur from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the only way you get that is if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you success and sends down upon you his barakah. You know, the best ways to do that is to begin with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قُلُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ مُبَارَكٌ كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ مُبَارَكٌ. Allah, he says, a book that we have sent down that is blessed. This is a book that we sent down that is blessed. وَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ إِنَّ لِلَّهِ أَهْلِينَ مِنَ النَّاسِ قَالُوا مَنْ هُمْ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ قَالَ أَهْلُ الْقُرْآنِ قَالَ أَهْلُ الْقُرْآنِ أَهْلُ اللَّهِ وَخَاصَتُهُ. The Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has special people from mankind. Allah, he has exclusive special people from mankind. The Sahaba, they said to the Messenger of Allah, who are they, O Messenger of Allah? He said, Ahl al-Quran, the people of the Quran. Allahu Akbar. Na'am, ameen, ya akhi. May Allah make us from them. Qala Ahl al-Quran, he said, the people of the Quran, Ahl Allah wa khasatu. They are the people of Allah, and they're the most close, special, near people to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we pose the question to my brothers and sisters, if the only thing you want is to become firm in knowledge and understand the Islamic sciences and become firm in them, is it not incumbent upon you to firstly tie yourself to al-marji' al-awwal, the first source of those Islamic sciences, that all the Islamic sciences are derived from, the Book of Allah, the Book of Allah that is blessed, that the individual who ties himself to it will always be blessed and be muwaffaq, yani have tawfiq from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Isn't incumbent upon you to begin with that before you begin becoming busy with the different sciences? Because there's things that's awla, and this is the method of the ulama of the past. They used to begin with the Quran. They used to memorize the Quran when they were in their childhood. Then they begin with becoming firm in the Arabic language. Then they begin with science, doing perfection from science to science. And that's the way of the ulama. And that's the way that we need to be, inshallah ta'ala. وكذلك, there's some athar from the Quran that come about when you memorize the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's some effects that come about you. You gain some new qualities when you memorize the Book of Allah in regards to ability. فَمَنْ حَفَظَ الْقُرْآنَ وَأَتْقَنَهُ سَيَمْلِكْ بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ مَلَكَةِ الْحِفْظِ فِي حِفْظِ الْمُتُونِ الْعِلْمِيَّةِ وَالْحَدِيثِ سَيَسْهُلَ عَلَيْهِ جِدًّا بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. For example, the person who memorized the Quran and perfects it, he now obtains the quality of being able to memorize. He now has the capability of memorizing. So after that, memorizing the scientific texts, whatever they may be from the different sciences, yani the texts of fiqh, the texts of aqidah, that become easy for him after he memorized the Book of Allah. Wala hadith, and the hadith of the Messenger of Allah, memorizing the sunnah will become extremely easy for that individual after he memorized the Book of Allah. We now see this kitab miftah kul al-ulum. This book, if you tie yourself to it and be diligent with it, it is the key to all of the sciences. It is that thing that will get you into the door of every science. وكذلك كثير من الأدلة موجودة في القرآن. And as well, a lot of the proof and evidences that are studied in these sciences are found in the Quran. And you will have them at your disposal when you have perfection of the memorization of the Quran. And this will allow you to move up the ladder of seeking knowledge and become more advanced. يعني when you have the understanding of the Book of Allah and you know where the ayat and the proofs and evidences are, and you can pull them to استحضرها, and you're able to pull them at any time that you will and wish. That's what comes from the barakah of the Quran, the barakah of memorizing and focus on the memorization of the Quran. وكذلك حفظ القرآن يعلمك الصبر. And as well, memorizing the Quran, it will teach you sabr, teaches you patience upon seeking knowledge of fiqh, seeking knowledge of aqidah, knowledge of all the different sciences. Teaches you patience. لأن القرآن لا يحفظ ولا يتقن إلا بالتكرار الكثير والمراجع الكثيرة. Because the Quran is not memorized and perfected except by repeating it many, many times and reviewing it often. And this is something that any person who has perfected the Quran and memorized the Quran knows. وكذلك العلوم الشرعية, and as well, the sciences of Islam are the same way. You must continue to repeat your lessons and study them and review them and teach them finally that they become, so that they become firm. Until you become like the ulama, as they say, يعني العلم, يعني نحن نريد أن نعيش مع العلم والعلم يعيش مع العلماء. We want to live with knowledge in our beginning stages of seeking knowledge. We want to live with knowledge. We're constantly reading and memorizing and reviewing. But the ulama, yani, got to the point that they've done that for so many years that the ilm begins to live with them. The knowledge begins to live with them. It's in them, meaning they possess it. It's in their hearts. And that's how we need to be. And that's, and the things that will allow you to do that is firstly by beginning with the memorization of the Quran so that you gain a strong ability to memorize. Na'am. Wa la siyama dhabt al-masail al-fiqhiyya. And especially perfecting the matters of fiqh, or the issues of fiqh, or the different branches of fiqh. It takes years to do that. It takes years to perfect them. And without having patience, you will never be able to do that. And if you memorize the Quran, inshallah ta'ala, after you learning the patience and learning what it takes to perfect something, then inshallah you will have longevity in this. And this is what we need. We ask Allah to give us longevity, يعني الاستمرارية. الاستمرارية. يعني having longevity and being continuous and seeking knowledge and not stopping after a year or two. This is, inshallah, we make it lifelong for the sake of Allah. We'll be in the sabir of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for our whole life. And that comes about by starting with the book of Allah. Allah gives you barakah. We're going to keep going back. Allah gives you success because you began with his book. Yani you preferred his book over everything. It's not taken from the sciences of Islam. Wallahi, that's what we're trying to do. But firstly, we need to begin with the book of Allah. Begin with the book of Allah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we prove to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we show Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we love him and we love his book. And we truly want this. And we know that we need to memorize this book so that we will be able to enable ourselves to become strong students. And this is of the first nasa'ih, of the first advices that the ulama give you, to start with the book of Allah. Na'am. And subhanAllah, I have some more advices and things like that, but the time is getting, I think I finished my time. But I leave us just one advice that our Shaykh Abdullah Abul Khayr has given us, he gave us. And he is a professor in the Islamic University of Medina. And a bikhtisar, I'm going through it quick, inshallah ta'ala. I do not want to hold you brothers and sisters up for too long. And firstly, may Allah reward you brothers and sisters for listening. And may Allah grant you all knowledge and yuthabbitukum ala deeni, and make you firm upon his religion, and reward you for listening to all these lectures. Naam. And make you all strong students of knowledge. Ameen. And us as well. Ameen. He said, قبل أن تذهب إلى درس شيخك اقرأ المتن وشرح الذي سيدرس ثلاث مرات بالتأني. He said, before you go to the lesson of your sheikh, before you go to the lesson of your sheikh, read the text and its explanation three times. Read the text and the explanation that is going to be taught three times by taking your time. Do not rush through it. Then go to the dars after you have done that. After you read it three times, بالتأني, يعني slowly trying to understand it, then go to the dars, then go to the lesson. And then pay attention to the dars, pay attention to your sheikh, pay attention to his sharh and his explanation, and record and write down the fawaid and the benefits that he's mentioning and those points that he's pointing to in making the metin clear. Write those down to dawinuha, yani record them. And at the end of the dars, when it's finished, ask the sheikh any question that you may have. For example, throughout your reading, the reading that you did before you went to the dars of the sheikh, some things that you didn't understand, this is your time now to ask. Ask those questions at that time, at the end of the class. And for example, the things that he might have said in his sharh, his explanation that you don't understand, ask them at that time. Ask them at the end of the class. So after that, you have read it three times, and you heard the explanation of the sheikh, and then you ask all the questions, and now you understand that dars, you understand that part of the metin, and the explanation of that metin, very well. And after you have done that, now go back and read it three more times. Then before you take the test, if you're in one of the jami'at, one of the universities, or your sheikh gives you test, راجع الدرس مرة أخرى. Then review the dars one more time. Now you have listened to, you have read the dars and studied it seven times, and you listened to the explanation of your sheikh. Now, inshallah ta'ala, that dars is thabit. Yani you've memorized the dars. And the sheikh said, inshallah ta'ala, if you do this with all your lessons that you take in the books, in the book that you're studying, inshallah ta'ala, you will perfect the book that you're studying, and you'll be able to perfect the science of fiqh, inshallah ta'ala. Now, I thank my brothers and sisters for listening. May Allah reward you. May Allah reward the brother Abdul Salam for his efforts. And that is, he's our يعني, a great example for us. Wallahi, we benefit from him. Inshallah, you brothers and sisters continue to benefit from him. He's beneficial. And la uzakihi ala Allah. Wa Allah hasibu. Yani, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows him best. But what we've seen from him of good efforts and striving to teach you brothers and sisters, yani, is something that is an example. And may Allah bless him and continue to bless him in this dunya and akhirah, and grant him Jannah, him and his family. Ameen. Subhanak Allah bihamdik, ashadu illa ilaha anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.
Jazakum Allah khair, Habibana Abu Ilyaas, for his beneficial lecture, insightful lecture. May Allah grant him and his family and his offsprings and his all of his family members Jannah Firdaus A'la. Ameen. Alhamdulillah. We thank everyone for their patience and their diligence in attending this conference. May Allah reward you all with Firdaus. Ameen.
Ameen.
Allah will have an exam for these lessons, and those who complete the exam, they will receive certificates for the course, as well as some gifts, inshallah ta'ala. The exam is very simple, and we'll put the details in the channel after we complete this session. Please forgive us for anything that was, you know, of inconvenience, or anything which, you know, from min taqsirina. Jazakum Allah khaira. Wallahu a'lam. Wassalamu alaikum.